mind can concentrate on at a stretch. And moderator is Dr. Darshana Rathod, madam, who is now the HOD of ophthalmology at Cooper Hospital and HBT Medical College, Mumbai. A little bit about myself. I basically practice oculoplastics in Mumbai. I began my practice in Pune, and now I'm attached to Cooper Hospital as an honorary visiting oculoplastic consultant. And this is where I have trained. So I acknowledge all my alma mater and training institutes before I begin this lecture. I don't like to make lectures very didactic and like to implement myself in different aspects. But considering that ptosis is an important exam case, we should go through everything about ptosis in these 45 minutes. Most of the theoretical part I would like you guys to read, because we have very good textbooks written by Indian authors where everything is given very systematically to write an answer. But what I'm going to do in these 45 minutes is try to clear certain concepts, because oculoplastics as a branch has always been given stepsisterly treatment in ophthalmology, especially in medical colleges and the teaching curriculum. So it's very rare that you get to see or opt on a case ptosis after you've finished 3 years of residency, especially in 80% of the colleges. The outline of the lecture is basically going to lie on anatomy, because anatomy is of utmost importance when dealing with any branch, surgical branch. Then we'll go on to classification and evaluation very quickly, and then focus more on management and the different types of management options that we have while dealing with a case of ptosis. Now, coming to the first and the foremost part is you need to know about the surface anatomy of the eyelid. The position of the upper eyelid usually is 1 to 2 millimeters just beneath the upper limbus. The lower eyelid lies just touching the lower limbus. The palpebral fissure height is 10 to 2 millimeters, and horizontal palpebral fissure ranges from 28 to 30 millimeters. You should also know that the lateral canthus lies 0.5 to 1 millimeters above the position of the medial canthus. This is all important because in ptosis, all these landmarks matter and it affects the eventual outcome of surgery. Now, whenever we look at a patient, we should look at the patient in three dimensions. So the eyelid is also a three-dimensional structure, in which around 5 to 6 layers are packed within a small space of 1 to 2 millimeters. We should know about these structures well in detail before we begin any form of surgery. Now, knowing the eyelid anatomy in cross section is of very much utmost importance, because this is what we are going to encounter when we take this patient up for surgery. So basically, there are two main parts of an eyelid, be it upper eyelid or the lower eyelid. There are two lamellae, the anterior and the posterior lamellae. There is minor variation in upper and lower eyelid anatomy, which we'll come to now. If you look at this is the cross section, the sagittal section of the upper eyelid. You can see that anterior to posterior, you encounter the skin, which is one of the thinnest skins in the body, striated muscle fibers of the orbicularis. The greenish structure that you see here is basically the levator muscle, the levator aponeurosis, which comes from behind, from the orbit into the anterior portion of the eyelid. The skeletal part of the eyelid is formed by the tarsus, which is again a very important structure considering the bony, surgical outcome. And then there's the Müller's muscle and the conch. The orbital septum lies above. It is basically important because it holds the preaponeurotic fat into place. And this preaponeurotic fat is basically the gliding force. This provides the glide for the muscles to move whenever the eyelid blinks. The roof fat pad is basically the subbrow fat pad, which lies much more superiorly. And we usually don't encounter this during ptosis surgery. That's the histological anatomy, which you can see where the orbit septum. This is the preaponeurotic fat mat, striated muscle fibers. You can see that the levator muscle comes here down, attaches anterior to the tarsus, superior to the tarsus, and sends some slips into the skin, which form the eyelid crease. The lower eyelid also has similar structure and function, except that the levator muscle is not very robust. It has been replaced by something called as the lower eyelid retractors. Now, this is the inferior oblique and the inferior rectus muscle. The sheath around it condenses and goes ahead and attaches to the tarsus, as similar to the upper eyelid. And this is called as the lower eyelid retractor. So lower eyelid retractor basically is very thin, not as robust as the levator, but is of function and importance, especially while considering entropy on surgery. The orbicularis muscle balances the opening of the levator. The orbicularis is the main protractor of the eyelid. It is divided into three parts, the pretarsal and the preseptal and the orbital part. Of our concern for today's lecture will be the pretarsal part and the preseptal part. It is very vascular muscle and it receives rich collaterals from both internal and external carotid circulation. The internal carotid circulation is mainly contributed by branches of the supracochlear, lacrimal and the supraorbital and the angular. And the external carotid circulation basically comes from a branch of the transverse facial artery. Medial and lateral canthal tendon complexes form the hammock and the support of the eyelid. As you can see here, this is the skeleton of the eyelid which has been bared apart. You can see the tarsus, the medial and the lateral canthal tendon, which is basically forming a eyelid hammock. Now, when we peel into this, we see the levator function, which comes in, the levator muscle, which comes into view. The levator muscle is basically a flat, square-shaped muscle, which originates from around the circle of Zinn, from the sphenoid bone, travels ahead above the superior rectus muscle in close relation with it, and transitions into the aponeurosis part at the Whitnall's ligament, which is marked here by a star. So basically, a very important point from the exam point of view is the origin, the insertion, and the innervation of the levator muscle. The insertion of the levator muscle basically is split into five parts. The lateral horn of the levator goes and attaches to the Whitnall's tubercle. The medial horn of the levator goes and attaches just around medial canthal tendon. And then there are three fibers which come ahead. One attaches onto the superior surface of the tarsus. One attaches to the anterior surface, just 2 millimeters beneath the margin. And one goes in, there are multiple slips which go onto the skin, which actually give rise to the eyelid fold. So the levator muscle has five terminal attachments. It is innervated by the third cranial nerve, the superior branch of the oculomotor nerve. Now the lateral horn of the levator also splits the lacrimal gland into two parts, the palpebral lobe and the orbital lobe. This is of importance because while splitting or while doing surgery on the levator, you should not go too laterally or you can damage some part of the palpebral part of the lacrimal gland. Now moving ahead, ptosis is everywhere. Actually, if you have keen eye, if you go back home, if you walk on the streets of Mumbai, you will see that ptosis, mild, moderate, severe, is found everywhere, especially the senile variant in Indian population. You can see that this famous celebrity also had a variant of ptosis, which is also called as a neurogenic variant or the myogenic variant. She has gotten operated multiple times with poor results. To classify ptosis, it is very easy. It is classified into congenital and acquired. Congenital could be either simple congenital or complicated congenital. And acquired is then further subdivided into aponeurotic or senile, neurogenic, myogenic, mechanical, and traumatic. Now, aponeurotic ptosis we'll come to further. Neurogenic ptosis is the form of ptosis which is basically in the form of transmission delay at the neuromuscular junction. So, ocular myasthenia gravis, Horner's syndrome, all these come into the neurogenic variants of ptosis. Myogenic ptosis basically involves all the mitochondrial and the other musculopathies like chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia, Kearns-Sarre syndrome, and other dystrophic myotonias. Mechanical ptosis is very easy to understand. It basically occurs when there is an eyelid mass which presses on the eyelid, causing mechanical drooping of the eyelid, and traumatic is self-explanatory. Now, a very favorite question of examiners is also, what is pseudotosis? So pseudotosis is basically not true ptosis, but ptosis which is apparent because of certain conditions. It could be ipsilateral, contralateral, and these are the various conditions which can cause pseudotosis. Now coming to the next part, whenever we see a ptosis patients in our clinics or whenever we decide to operate upon a ptosis patient, you have to differentiate it into two points. One, whether we should be operating the ptosis patient or not. Second, if we need to operate it, what all measurements need to be done. So this is a quick checklist which will help you in the examination as well to basically examine a case of ptosis. First, you measure the palpebral fissure height, which is very easy to measure. for all these measurements, you need to sit exactly opposite the patient, have a transparent scale or a ruler in hand. Your head position should match with the head position of the patient, and you should be sitting straight ahead with a light reflex thrown by either an assistant or with the other hand. So palpebral fissure height has to be measured, followed by the margin reflex distance. Now, margin reflex distance is MRD1 and MRD2. MRD1 is of more importance when dealing with a case of ptosis. It is the distance between the central corneal reflex and the height of the upper eyelid in the mid-pupillary plane. This usually varies from 3 to 5 centimeters and is reduced in a case of ptosis. If the ptosis is covering the visual axis, then marginal reflex distance can also be measured as zero or in the negative. After you lift the eyelid, whatever the excursion of the eyelid is, it is labeled as -2, -1, -3, depending on whatever the excursion is. Bell's phenomena or reflex is very important to see, because this is one of the protective reflexes that the eyeball and the eyelid offer in cases of ptosis surgery. So it is important, because after ptosis surgery, especially if the congenital variant, you can end up with a lag of thalamus, and Bell's phenomena protects these patients from exposure keratopathy, especially when the patient is asleep. Corneal status and Schirmer's test is again important to rule out dry eye, because you don't operate in a case of severe dry eye. Eyelid crease distance is important, especially in general anesthesia cases. This is a distance between the most major eyelid crease or the most prominent eyelid crease, which is seen from the cilia margin. So eyelid crease distance is important when you are operating a case of congenital unilateral ptosis, so that you can replicate the eyelid crease on the other side to give better symmetry and better aesthetic value. Now, the most important test which we need to perform before deciding what surgery should be done is the levator function. Now, levator function can be assessed with the help of a certain particular method, which I'll be discussing later. Marcus Kahn jaw winking is again one thing which you need to examine, especially in cases of congenital ptosis, because the management can vary because of this phenomena. Dry eye evaluation, as I already spoke about, and then presence or absence of a squint or motility disturbance, as seen in some variants of myogenic and neurogenic ptosis, should be ruled out, because if there is a squint, it needs to be operated before a ptosis surgery is performed. Last but not the least, if a ptosis patient walks into your clinic, you always tell them to bring old photographs, which I also called as the FAT scan or family assisted tomography, because this gives you an idea as to the amount of ptosis that was there present since birth or childhood and how it has varied, or if it has varied at all during the growing up age. Now, levator function is basically measured with the help of a ruler. It can be either do with an assistant or you can do it yourself. It is important to occlude the frontalis muscle whenever you're measuring the levator, because you don't want to measure the frontalis action, which can be added in cases of ptosis. You ask the patient to look down and then look up and measure the excursion on the scale. Depending on the excursion, it can be graded as excellent, good, fair, and poor. All this grading can be found in the books. Now, why this is important? Because depending on the amount of levator function is how you decide what management is to be offered to these patients. I also spoke about Marcus Kahn jaw winking. So Marcus Kahn jaw winking is basically synkinesis, which is the video seen?
Video is not playing, like there is a lag, I suppose.
Okay. So Marcus Kahn jaw winking synkinesis is basically when there is an aberrant innervation from one of the muscles of the jaw, basically it's the pterygoid muscles, to the levator palpebrae muscles of the eyelid. So whenever the patient moves his jaw sideways or forward or makes a balloon out of the mouth, the eyelid excursion, the eyelid which is affected, moves up and down. So it basically gives a dancing movement. Why this is important? Because whenever this is there, we need to wait it out before planning to operate on these patients, and the surgical management varies. Now, coming to the management of ptosis, I think there is a little bit of lag because of the... Should I delete the videos?
Because no, it's okay. If they are not getting played, you can show in the end. Okay. Now you can see.
So, depending on the amount of levator function nowadays, there are lots of surgeries which can be offered to the patient depending on what structure you are operating on and what is the amount of resection being performed. So these surgeries range from Muller's muscle resection to LPS resection, mitral sling, supramaximal LPS resection, and then frontalis sling. For the ease of postgraduate students, I'm going to discuss about frontalis sling surgery, levator resection surgery, and Muller's muscle resection surgery, because these are the three most commonly performed surgeries nowadays for ptosis patients. Now we're going to change gears and just talk about different case scenarios and how they can be managed and how the management protocol varies and how we manage a case of ptosis when different cases come to us. Now, imagine that a 5-year-old female patient walks into your clinic with this. What you can see here is there is certain amount of ptosis here on the right hand side. You can see multiple eyelid creases here as compared to a single prominent eyelid crease on the left hand side. And there is around a 1 to 1.5 millimeter droop on the right as compared to the left. But the pupillary axis is clear. Now, when we refracted this child, she had a plus 3.5 cycloplegic refraction, which is for the same. Eyelid lag, which is present here on the right hand side when she looks in down gaze. Now, why is this lid lag present? Now, consider this eyelid to be like a pulley or a curtain. Whenever there is dysgenesis of the levator, which is seen in cases of congenital ptosis, that is fibrosis of the levator or stiffening of the levator, the eyelid is not going to be supple. So, the eyelid is going to get pulled, it is going to be fibrotic, and the eyelid muscle is going to pull the eyelid up, and you're going to get a lid lag on down gaze. So, lid lag on down gaze is one of the cardinal features in a case of congenital ptosis. So, whenever you see a child with lid lag on down gaze, asymmetric lid lag, with a poor LPS function, it is congenital ptosis, and usually depending on the amount of ptosis, in this case, the visual axis was clear. There was no induced astigmatism. So in such cases, the rule of thumb is to observe. Let this child grow up, and then you can either perform a levator resection surgery or a sling surgery, depending on your choice. Levator resection surgery now can be performed even in age group less than 3 years. Coming to the second point that I want to drive through here is this case. Now, we saw a case where there was a lid lag on down gaze, but here if you see, there is a complete lid drop on down gaze. And this is how cases of senile or aponeurotic ptosis present. If you see, there is some amount of levator function. If you draw a line, you can see that the levator function is certainly there. But when the patient looks in down gaze, if you look at the other eye, the cornea seems to be open, the pupillary reflex is open, but here the lid is covering the whole of the cornea and the pupillary reflex. So this is a clear-cut case of aponeurotic ptosis or levator disinsertion. This is what we will see in age group of 40 and above in patients with VKC or vernal conjunctivitis who rub their eyes very often, in cases of allergic eye disease, in cases of blepharocolysis, where there is an allergic insult to the eye causing rubbing of the eyes. So lid lag on down gaze, or eyelid drop on down gaze, or lid drop on down gaze is a cardinal sign of aponeurotic ptosis. And if you see a patient like this, the surgery of choice is levator plication. Coming to the second case scenario, look at this 5-year-old male child with bilateral ptosis, left more than right. He has a little bit of exudate deviation in the left eye. There has been no progression of this eyelid position since birth, according to the parents. Now, what do? You examine this child and see that he has a little bit of difference in visual acuity as on the left-hand side as compared to the right. Rest, all the examination is normal. The marginal reflex distance is almost zero on the left, and the levator function is poor on both the sides. Now, these are perfect candidates for an early ptosis surgery. So, this is both eye congenital ptosis, left more than right. You operate the left eye first, followed by the right eye. surgery could either vary from a levator resection to a silicone sling, which was done in this case, and this is how it looks after the surgery. So the main aim in these cases is to clear the visual axis so that you can give them proper amblyopia therapy and the vision can be restored before the amblyopia age group is surpassed. Now, as I spoke about different surgeries, the choice of surgeries in ptosis basically depends on the amount of ptosis and the levator function, which we've already learned to evaluate. If the levator function is good and the ptosis is minimal, less than 2 millimeters, you can either do a Fasanella Servette procedure, which is not done nowadays. It was done before, but a lot of your examiners might want to know about this as well. So Fasanella Servette procedure is basically done if the levator function is good and you have mild ptosis. A newer variant of Fasanella Servette procedure is the molarectomy or the Muller's muscle resection, which I am going to talk about today if the video plays well. And then you can also do a LPS resection or LPS plication in these cases. When the amount of ptosis is moderate, that is 3 millimeters, with a good levator function, the procedure of choice is a levator resection surgery. And if the ptosis is very severe with a poor levator function, you can either do a supramaxillary LPS resection or you perform a frontalis suspension, which is our favorite surgery and an easy surgery to do. Now, coming to the next part, the amount of levator resection which is performed is based on various nomograms which were given by Beard. This is not very important from postgraduate point of view, but you should at least know that there are nomograms which are available. Basically, depending on the amount of levator resected or depending on the amount of levator function which is there. I follow this nomogram, which is the Burpee's nomogram. It is very helpful in cases of congenital ptosis under general anesthesia. So the amount of, if the amount of levator function is poor, then the eyelid height which has to be kept at the end of the surgery is higher. Now, basically, when to operate childhood ptosis or congenital ptosis, this is a matter of debate, but usually the age group which is prescribed nowadays is basically a pre-screwal age group, around 4 to 5 years of age, because nowadays children have become very smart and they develop complex or it is difficult for them to interact socially with other children. Second age group when it can be performed is the teenage age group, around 16 to 17 years of age, when they're just entering college. Or then in India, a lot of patients come to us just before marriage to get it corrected for cosmetic reasons. Now, the advantage of performing this surgery when before marriage or when the child grows up is that it can be performed under local anesthesia. Local anesthesia is a very good way to perform this surgery because then you can titrate the amount of eyelid elevation on table because the patient is cooperating. Now, all said and done, you should operate ptosis early if there is amblyopia because you don't want the child to end up with amblyopia, because amblyopia therapy cannot be done after the age of 12 successfully in most of the cases. Coming to scenario 3, look at this 23-year-old female. Now, we experience these cases very often now, especially because of selfie mania and social media pressure. Whenever people take pictures on the cell phone, it's two-dimensional. So even a small amount of asymmetry gets unmasked. And nowadays, we get patients with ptosis even to the tune of 0.5 to 1 millimeter wanting to get it corrected. Now, this lady has ptosis in the right eye as compared to the left. Left eye is also a little bit ptotic, but the right eye is certainly more ptotic than the left. MRD is around 0.1. It's written wrong here. It's around 0.5 to 1 millimeter. In such cases, what can you offer the patient? It is very difficult to do a levator surgery in these cases with very good predictability value. So you do a phenylephrine test. Now, this is an important test from the exam point of view. One of the examiners usually asks this in your viva. Phenylephrine in the range of 2% is instilled in the eye with ptosis, and the amount of eyelid elevation is measured. If the eyelid elevation is more than 1 millimeter, it is considered as a mild response to phenylephrine. If it is more than 2 millimeters, it is considered as a moderate to good response and is a good candidate for Muller's muscle surgery. In this case, if you see this red bottle is the phenylephrine bottle which I've used, and you can see a good elevation on the right-hand side, almost symmetrical to the other side. So phenylephrine test is a good test to do, especially if you are considering Muller's muscle surgery. And this you can see, we can achieve good correction, especially for cosmetically oriented patients with a Muller's muscle conjunctival resection. Now let me see if I can play this video, if I can, well and good, otherwise I'll play it at the end of the presentation. So Muller's muscle conjunctival resection surgery is a very easy surgery, again based on nomograms. I don't think that this is visible right now.
No, because, it's not.
So I'll play it at the end of the...
We'll do. No.
Now coming to the next... After every video it is getting stuck. I'll do, just yes. Give me a minute. I'm deleting all the videos from the PowerPoint.
Will do. So, meanwhile, Darshan ma'am, we can take a few questions till he is adjusting.
I have already taken down this question.
Yes, ma'am.
First person, what was the, someone has asked, how do we measure MRD in a case of squint? So for this, what my opinion is, the first thing is the squint is corrected and only then we can go for the ptosis evaluation of such patient. Aditya will be again a better, he can again give us a better explanation regarding this.
So what madam said is completely true. What I will like to add in this is, if the patient has squint, suppose the patient has an exotropia, what you can do is you can occlude the other eye, get the patient in primary position and then perform the MRD measurement in such cases, because then it becomes easier to perform.
Okay. Now, should second, we go for the second questions? Second question was, how do you differentiate between dermatocalosis and blepharocalosis?
So this is actually a theoretical answer. Dermatocalosis is basically when there is an overhanging eyelid fold because of aging changes. So whenever the eyelid tissue gets lax, whenever the structural support and stability is lost, when the eyelid fold hangs down, it is called as dermatocalosis. Blepharocalosis is the same condition, same anatomy, which happens when the patient suffers from recurrent angioedema or allergic eye disease, where there is recurrent allergic inflammation of the eyelid, which causes loosening and thinning of the eyelid skin, thinning and attenuation of the orbicularis muscle, causing papery, thin, wrinkled skin appearance of the eyelid. So blepharocalosis and dermatocalosis is basically extra hanging eyelid fold. The only thing is that the etiology is different. In blepharocalosis, it is because of allergy, while in dermatocalosis, it is because of aging.
Aditya, you are ready with the presentation. We'll continue the same.
Okay. So coming to the next scenario, which we are seeing here, this is a young male. You can obviously see there's unilateral toes there. What you can see in addition is that there is a faint eyelid crease, which is more medial. And as you trace it superiorly, it has migrated up. So this is one more indicator of a disinserted levator. The other eye is normal. Now on examination, if you see, this patient has moderate ptosis, the visual axis is clear, and he is in the pre-marriage age group. Rest, all the ocular examination is normal. The levator function is good, 14 millimeters. The Bell's phenomena is good. So this is again a case of acquired ptosis because of levator disinsertion. Higher eyelid crease on the affected side is one more sign of aponeurotic ptosis along with eyelid drop on down gaze. This is an outcome after levator resection surgery. You can see that the eyelid fold has symmetrized on both the sides just by attaching the levator to its normal position. in these cases, you sometimes don't even have to resect the levator because the levator function is very good. Now, this is a spot diagnosis. This is one of the most favorite PG questions, or sometimes a PG case can be kept. This is a young female with a family history of ptosis. Her sibling also has similar looking appearance. What is this? This is blepharophimosis syndrome. Blepharophimosis syndrome is basically a triad of ptosis, epicanthus inversus, and telecanthus. Now, ptosis is usually can be mostly commonly bilateral. There are cases reported with unilateral ptosis as well. Telecanthus is widening of intercanthal distance here, and epicanthus inversus is a small fold of eyelid which goes upwards. Now, blepharophimosis syndrome has a genetic predisposition. There are two genes, BPES1 and BPES, which usually are affected in these cases. There are two types of blepharophimosis syndromes. You don't need to go into the details. And very commonly in women, this syndrome can be associated with ovarian failure and polycystic ovarian disease. So this is one thing that you need to know with blepharophimosis syndrome. Usually in Fimosis syndrome, the ptosis is moderate to severe and might need correction. These children usually do very well with frontalis suspension surgery. Levator is usually atrophic or replaced with fat. So levator surgery doesn't work very well in these cases. Tarsofrontal sling or frontalis suspension, as it is more commonly called, is basically adherence of the levator muscle to the frontalis muscle. So what we are doing is we are taking some help of the frontalis muscle because the levator function is not good and the levator function is levator muscle is not acting properly. So the principle of this surgery is to form an adhesion between the frontalis and the levator muscle so that whenever the eyebrow is elevated, the eyelid also elevates. It's not a very physiological surgery, but that is the last choice, especially in cases of very poor ptosis. It was first described in a pentagon fashion by Beard, and then it was modified in different ways. This is called as the pentagon, and this is called as the Fox triangle, modified Fox triangle. It is used as a temporary measure in most of the cases and has to be repeated once or twice during their lifetime. There are various materials which can be used for frontalis suspension. They can be either autogenous, that is from your own body, in which fascia lata is the most common material that is used. This is more so permanent and is usually performed after the age of 18 years because that is when the development of fascia lata happens. Allogenic can also be used in the form of banked fascia lata, pericardium or collagen strips. This is not very commonly performed. And then the third most commonly performed is use of silicone suspension. So silicone suspension kits are available, which can be used to form an adhesion between the eyebrow and the eyelid muscle. In very young children, when we are trying to prevent amblyopia, we use either a 3-0 or a 4-0 ethibond suture to suspend eyelid so that we can give them amblyopia therapy. The video which I'm going to show you later on is basically the use of 3-0 ethibond to perform frontalis suspension in a young child. Coming to the sixth case scenario, suppose a patient like this walks into your trauma casualty with sudden in onset droopy eyelid, history of trauma, you can see a small abrasion there, and complete paresis of the extraocular muscles. Now, what does your mind wander onto? There can be two scenarios. One, you need to do a complete examination in such cases. If the motility is restricted, what you see here is a very good presentation of a third nerve palsy. Complete third nerve palsy can present like this. So you need to lift the eyelid and evaluate the pupils. If the pupil is dilated, you need send for imaging to rule out any intracranial lesion. The pupil is still constricted and the motility is restricted. Third nerve palsies usually do not require urgent intervention unless there is an intracranial cause. In a clear-cut case of trauma, once an MRI or imaging is performed to rule out any pathology, you can wait on these cases. So ideal approach to such cases would be to give them some reassurance, give them some amount of multivitamins, and we call them after a period of 2 to 3 months again, because most of these cases, around 50% of them, spontaneously improve and the ptosis improves. Second scenario here could be a disinsertion of the levator. So blunt trauma sometimes here can cause disinsertion of the levator and complete traumatic ptosis. In such cases, the levator function will not be measurable because the levator has been transected or disinserted, but the pupil will be normal and the extraocular motility will be normal. So this is a differentiating point between a case of third nerve palsy versus traumatic disinsertion of the levator. Now coming to the second subset of ptosis, which we see very commonly, is acquired neurogenic ptosis, which again can be because of a third nerve palsy, or then it could be because of myasthenia gravis. So suppose a lady like this comes to your clinic with, has been since 20 years of age, she is now 45 years of age. The progression has been gradual. Right now, she doesn't have any variability, no dysphagia or no limb weakness, and no history of cardiac disease. Now, you see in primary gaze, there is exotropia, bilateral, left more than right, and mostly the extraocular muscle motility is affected. Now, this is a clear-cut case of myogenic ptosis. Most common presentation is chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia. Unfortunately, these cases don't have any definitive management. Management is in the form of supportive therapy like crutch glasses. Diagnosis is based on a muscle biopsy which is performed to see the mitochondrial changes. We also need to rule out cardiac diseases in these cases because they can be associated with certain mitochondrial myopathies. Myasthenia gravis is again a very commonly seen ptosis, usually comes from a neurologist. The three most important tests which need to be done in the case of myasthenia gravis are ice pack test, which can be done in the clinic, fatigue test, and hydrophonium test, or neostitch, which we nowadays commonly perform. Look at this young individual with a 1 month onset of ptosis, which has been subacute in onset. It has been asymmetric, associated with some amount of diplopia, and a definitive diurnal variation. All these pointers point towards myasthenia gravis. Now, myasthenia gravis can be limited to the ocular muscles as well. There has been a subvariant which has been classified as ocular myasthenia gravis. Ice pack test usually is positive after 2 minutes of ice pack occlusion if there is a change in position of the eyelid after putting the ice pack, as seen in this picture. It is a positive ice pack test. So this is when you investigate further for myasthenia and then perform either the fatigue test or the neostigmine test. Neostigmine test has a higher sensitivity as compared to ice pack and fatigue test. Other investigations which can be supportive in a case of myasthenia gravis is anti-acetylcholine receptor antibody test and repetitive nerve stimulation test, which is the most sensitive test in cases of ocular myasthenia gravis. Now, myasthenia gravis, the treatment is well known. We need to send them to a neurologist, or you can yourself start them on a trial of pyridostigmine, which shows usually immediate response. Sometimes some cases might need steroid therapy, especially if autoimmune etiology has been suspected. Another test that you need to do in cases of myasthenia gravis is a CT scan of the chest to rule out a thymoma. Now, what are the management options for myopathic ptosis, which we already discussed? No surgery is the most important, most commonly done, because usually it's not very successful. Eyelid crutch glasses are very helpful for these cases, especially for their daily activities. Some people have reported some amount of success in moderate cases of myopathic ptosis in the form of transofrontal suspension, which we already spoke about. The material of choice is silicone because it is reversible. These cases sometimes have a risk of corneal exposure because of poor Bell's phenomenon. Now, to conclude, ptosis basically needs good clinical evaluation. You need to know about the function. You need to rule out different causes of ptosis. Most commonly, ptosis in your clinic or in private practice would come to you in the form of acquired or congenital ptosis. But you need to keep an eye on these various conditions which are associated with ptosis, because these are red flag indicators. You should not miss these conditions, because these have other outcomes and other implications as well while managing a case of ptosis. Now, let me quickly go to the video. If you want, I can quickly take some questions, because the videos are going to be self-explanatory, especially to understand what all is done for cases of ptosis.
Aditya, can you please re-explain how do we measure MRD1 in severe ptosis?
Yes. So let me show you a photo so that is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So suppose this patient comes to you, better this patient, and you are sitting in front of the lid. Now you cannot see the pupillary reflex here. Suppose the pupillary reflex is here for all practical purposes. Now in this case, when you keep the ruler like this, the light reflex is not going to be seen. So when the light reflex just is congruent with the eyelid, the MRD1 is zero. If the eyelid covers the light reflex, so the eyelid position was here, then the MRD would be, so if this is 1 millimeter, 2 millimeters, MRD would be -2. So if the eyelid is covering the light reflex, you lift the eyelid with your thumb, and the amount of eyelid excursion on the scale would be labeled as minus. So MRD1 can be in negative, especially if the eyelid is covering the light reflex. Anything else?
One of the PGs has a question, like, how do we check the corneal sensation if a patient is having bilateral ptosis?
So corneal sensation basically is independent. It's not of any importance in especially evaluating a case of ptosis. It is of more importance when you are considering surgery, because you don't want to operate a case of ptosis in patient who has reduced corneal sensation, because the blink will be affected. Corneal sensation can be measured with the same principle that you follow for any other test. You just lift the eyelid either with the help of an esthesiometer or with a cotton wick. You just touch the eyelid and see whether the patient blinks or not. Even if the patient has ptosis, the blink reflex is not affected. So basically, corneal function is evaluated by the strength of the blink reflex and not by the amount of ptosis.
Do we have any video which shows how the levator function is assessed?
I will have to check now, ma'am. I might not have it immediately, but
someone has asked, like, how to place the thumb, or at what level the thumb should be placed.
So occlusion, yeah. So basically, let me show you. So you see this picture. So in this picture, it is visible where you place the thumb. The thumb is just placed above the eyebrow, and you don't apply a lot of force to the eyebrow because you don't want to negate. So the thumb is placed just in this direction. Now, in the exam, the examiner can ask you about the second method also. There are two methods. One is you take the help of an assistant. The assistant negates both the frontalis muscles, stands from behind the patient and negates the frontalis muscle, and you sit in front and use the scale to measure. The second is a single examiner method, which is shown here, where you, with one finger, you negate the frontalis muscle and then ask the patient to look up and down.
Okay. I think this is how to do a fatigue test, but
fatigue test is also very easy to perform. You tell the patient to look in straight gaze, sit in front of the patient, give them a pointer or give them a target, fixation target in the up gaze. So the patient has to keep looking up, and you should keep it minimum for a period of 2 minutes. After 2 minutes, if the patient is myasthenic, automatically the eyelid will start drooping down, and the patient will make effort to lift it up. And when you ask the patient to look straight, the patient is then going to, you are going to see a droopy eyelid, which was not there before, because all the function, all the neurosynaptic acetylcholine has been exhausted easily before, which was present before.
This I think is important. How do we assess levator function in preschool children?
So it is very difficult to, in preschool children, it is very difficult to assess levator function. This is a very good question, but usually there are certain indicators. You can use a rattle, you can use a toy and ask the patient's mother to hold the patient in hand and then take the rattle and toy and move it up and down and see if the eyelid moves. So it is a rough measurement. It's not a very accurate measurement. Second way is to look at the eyelid crease. So if there is a good eyelid crease which is there, you can assume that the levator function is normal. So let me show you one picture so that it becomes self-explanatory. So now this person has a moderate ptosis, but you see this eyelid crease which is there. The eyelid crease is present. So that is why there has to be some assumption that the levator function is moderate to fair. As compared to that, if you see this patient, the eyelid crease is present, but it is very faint. So the levator function is not very good. That is our assumption. Similarly, in this patient, the eyelid crease is again very faint. So the levator function is poor as was found on measurement. So in preschool age group, basically it is assumption and experience that helps rather than practical measurements.
Again, why do we, in sling surgeries, you mentioned that facial attach should be used, should be considered after 18 years.
Yeah, so whoever asks this question has read literature very well. I mentioned that because I thought this was a lecture for postgraduate students. And usually examiners would like to have the most common answers. So usually if you look at recent publications, facial attach has been used in children even at the age group of 4 to 5 years of age. But if you are asked this question in an exam, it is better and safe to say that facial attach should be harvested after the age of 18. And you can add later on that recent publication show that it can be used in children above the age of 4 years as well. But to be safe, you should rather say that it is used in adults. There's one more question by the same person, I think, who has said that why levator resection surgery cannot be performed in blepharophimosis syndrome. Again, it is not a rule of thumb, but for generalized postgraduate students over here, sling surgery works better in blepharophimosis syndrome. If the levator function is good and the amount of ptosis is mild to moderate, you can perform a levator resection surgery in these patients as well. But 90% of the cases would require sling surgery.
How would you manage a jaw winking ptosis?
So jaw winking ptosis, usually there are only two ways to manage it. Old school of thought says that you extirpate the levator. That is, you dissect the levator and separate it completely from all its disinserted from its origin and insertion so that it starts floating in the orbit, and then perform a sling surgery. Usually, if you are performing a sling surgery for a Marcus gun jaw winking phenomena, it should be performed bilateral. So even if one eye is normal, you have to perform the sling surgery on the other eye also, along with levator extirpation. That is the old school of thought. Recently, when we saw more and more cases of Marcus gun jaw winking, we have been performing levator resection directly in these cases without extirpating levator, and have got good outcomes. What happens is that we have seen that the amplitude of the jaw winking reduces when we perform a levator resection. It has something to do with the proprioception of the eyelid. So recent literature shows that there are proprioceptors in the Müller's muscle which get readjusted when levator resection is performed in cases of Marcus gun jaw winking. So either levator extirpation with frontalis sling or levator resection is the surgery to be performed for jaw winking, but you cannot completely eliminate the jaw winking even after you perform both the surgeries.
Sumit, I cannot see the questioners. If you can, like what I had put up.
Okay, ma'am. There are few questions. Like in a case where there is a ptosis and congenital cataract coexisting, what should be operated first?
So this is like, did the egg come first or the chicken? Ideally, congenital cataract should be operated before ptosis, according to me, but it can vary. You can even operate ptosis before, because it depends on the severity of ptosis also. If the ptosis is very severe, you might have to perform both surgeries within a period of 1 week itself, because the main aim of congenital cataract surgery is to prevent amblyopia. So if the ptosis is hampering vision development, you have to perform the ptosis surgery immediately or before performing the congenital cataract surgery. Mind you, that ptosis surgery performed at any time is not going to cause any risk of endophthalmitis. So you don't have to worry about ptosis surgery causing endophthalmitis in these patients.
Correct. So it basically depends on the severity of the ptosis and how the visual axis will be open post-surgery, and also how much of astigmatism it is already putting and what each patient is presenting. So all need to be considered when you answer this question. Then Dr. Vishal Gupta wants to know sequence of the treatment surgeries in GPS correction.
Correct. So this is also one important question that we need to address. There are two schools of thought in this again. One school of thought says that you perform the ptosis surgery earlier if there is a risk of amblyopia, followed by epicanthus and telecanthus surgeries, because the nasal bone develops after up to the age of 5 to 6 years. That is why we perform a DCR after the age of 5 years. We don't perform a DCR before unless it is emergency. So usually my sequence of performing surgeries is perform the ptosis surgery first if the patient is amblyogenic, followed by performing epicanthal correction of epicanthal and telecanthal correction. Now the second school of thought disagrees with me and says that if you perform the ptosis surgery first, then the palpebral fissure aperture is going to change. And when you perform the epicanthus and the telecanthus surgery, the eyelid aperture is going to stretch again. So it's like a rubber band. If you correct the telecanthus, the rubber band is going to get pulled and the ptosis is going to worsen. But a lot of people say that this doesn't happen practically. So both ways are correct. There is no fixed way to manage blepharophimosis syndrome. But the final way, the one important thing is that if there is amblyopia in these cases, you need to do the ptosis surgery first before correcting the epicanthal and the telecanthal part.
Then this two question, yeah, it's about importance and assessment of the hearing's law in preoperative assessment, and also the same doctor wants to know the management of blepharocalysis.
Correct. So Herring's law is very important. It is seen in around 50 to 60% of the cases of ptosis, more so in cases of congenital ptosis. Now Herring's law is important from the counseling part of view. It is not going to affect your surgical outcome on the eyelid that you are performing surgery, but on the opposite side. So especially in today's times when the patients are going to ask you so many questions, it is very important to show them the Herring's reflex if present. Herring's reflex basically is when you lift one eyelid, especially the ptotic eyelid, the other eyelid starts drooping. Now this is important because in a case of bilateral ptosis, if one eyelid is already moderately ptotic and the other is mild ptosis, and you correct the moderate ptosis side, the mildly ptotic eyelid is going to become ptotic further, which is going to cause a problem. And usually patients or parents are going to attribute your surgery leading to worsening of ptosis on the other side. So Herring's law is very important, especially in pre-op counseling of patients with congenital ptosis. Second question, coming to the management of blepharocalysis, medical and surgical. Management of blepharocalysis is mainly medical. 80% of the cases resolve with medical treatment only. It is basically routine antihistaminic treatment. You need to give them ice compresses. Usually they get attacks every one or two months. It is usually painless. The eyelid will swell. They usually get these attacks in the morning when they wake up. So you give them a course of antihistaminics for a week or so. If the attacks are more frequent, you need to give the antihistaminics for a longer period of time. Usually also see for presence of papillae on the tarsus in these cases because they might have coexisting eyelid allergy. If the blepharochoresis is very severe, you need to refer an allergy specialist to rule out any known cause of allergy. Surgical management of blepharochoresis is performed after these blepharochoresis attacks subside. So if you have a 1 or 2 year period of no blepharochoresis attacks and the patient has a burnt out disease, which is evident in the form of wrinkling of the upper eyelid skin, which is papery thin, that is when you go ahead and perform a blepharoplasty and a ptosis surgery if the levator aponeurosis is disinserted.
Just to add to this, Adit, for the blepharochoresis, which is like not getting control with the anti-allergics, the oral steroids do work well. Yes. And sometimes in very severe cases, we often tried even IVMP 1 or 2 yes. doses, which basically reduces the inflammation to a lot of the extent.
Correct. Yeah.
Now, there is one last question. I will just change the question the way it is asked. It has been asked that advantages and disadvantages of Crawford and Fox Pentagon. I just want to ask you, if you given a choice, what will you prefer, a Crawford triangle technique or the Fox Pentagon technique?
So the answer to this is again very diplomatic. Lot of people like to name surgeries in their name. Basically, the principles of all these surgeries are same. It is forming an adhesion from the eyelid muscle to the eyebrow muscle, be it the Crawford's Pentagon, the Fox Modified Triangle. When I trained, I started with Crawford's Pentagon because it looks very fancy and is a good surgery to perform. And slowly, as I have experienced more and more cases and more surgeries, I have changed my technique to a Crawford's triangle because the amount of dissection and the amount of trauma that you're causing to the tissues is minimal. And the outcome that you're going to get is the same. All said and done, there are various studies which show the outcome of two different techniques of ptosis surgery performed by the same surgeon. And most of the outcomes have been the same. So there is no difference in outcomes whenever you use either the Crawford's or the Fox technique.
Okay. While you're answering this question, there are one more question that has popped up, and it's management of congenital ptosis with the superior rectus under action. So it's like a poor Bell's phenomenon and a poor LPS both. So it's like a double elevator palsy. How do you manage? Correct.
So double elevator palsy, usually these cases should be managed after the age of 18 because you would like to manage them when you can perform these surgeries under local anesthesia. In these cases, first the superior rectus surgery is performed. So whatever squint surgery has to be performed should be performed before, because sometimes you might need to perform an inferior rectus procedure along with a superior rectus procedure in these cases. What this does is that all these muscles are interlinked to the eyelid architecture. So whenever you perform an inferior rectus surgery, the eyelid palpebral fissure is going to change. You might end up causing an eyelid retraction in the lower eyelid. So you need to finish off the squint surgeries followed by a ptosis surgery. Ptosis surgery, the procedure of choice is levator resection in such cases. And under local anesthesia, because then you can titrate the amount of eyelid height that you want to achieve and also titrate the amount of Bell's that you see in these cases. If the Bell's is completely absent, then I would go ahead and perform a silicone sling because then it becomes a reversible surgery. Mm-hmm.
Can maternal facial atta be used in a young children?
This is a very unique question. We have used maternal skin grafts in cases of ichthyosis, where the whole skin is affected. But I have not, it is my ignorance if I have not read about any report of maternal facial atta, but I think it can be used because it is an inert tissue. It is not going to have any antigenic value. So for all practical purposes, you can use maternal facial atta. But recent studies show that you can perform facial atta surgery even in the age group of 4 to 6 years old. So I don't think you need to use maternal facial atta.
So ma'am, should we go ahead with the videos?
So what I'll do is, if they run without a gap, then I'll quickly show them. But if there is a delay, then
no problem.
Let's see how to manage. So first video which I'll show is of a levator resection surgery. Now, levator resection, as we all know, this surgery can be performed under local or general anesthesia, both. This is being performed under general anesthesia. Most important step is to mark the eyelid crease. After you mark the eyelid crease, the incision can be made either with a monopolar electrode, not in the times of corona, or with a scalpel, which can be used depending on the surgeon's preference. Now, we have seen the anatomy of the levator muscle. This is the orbicularis muscle, which is reddish pink in color. After the orbicularis, what you see is the whitish tarsus, the arcade, and the orbital septum. So now what I am opening up here is the orbital septum. After the orbital septum is opened up, the yellowish pre-aponeurotic fat comes into view, and the levator aponeurosis and the Muller's muscle can be seen. So this is the levator aponeurosis, the whitish part that you're seeing. Again, I'm opening up the septum from the over surface of the levator. The assistant holds the levator, and this yellowish pouch which you are seeing is the pre-aponeurotic fat pad. Now, these are small interconnections seen between the pre-aponeurotic fat and the levator muscle. This is the junction of the...
Screen size can be increased.
Screen size... Is it better now?
Yeah, okay.
Now, what you see here is the distinction between the three layers. This is the levator aponeurosis. This is the levator junction. This is the levator fibers that you're seeing, the white or pinkish part. And this is the pre-aponeurotic fat. This distinction is very important because this is where you're going to pass the sutures. After the levator has been dissected completely, you keep the fat in the retractor. The whitish ligament that you see here is the Whitnall's ligament. Now, the Whitnall's ligament can be displaced in certain cases of ptosis. You can find a low-lying Whitnall's or a high-lying Whitnall's, and this is the lacrimal gland. So, the lateral part is the lacrimal gland. This bulge is the lacrimal gland, so you don't touch that area. Now, this is the tarsus. This is the marginal arterial arcade, the reddish serpentine thing that you see. Now, the principle of levator resection or levator reattachment surgery is the same. Any ptosis surgery, the principle is the same. You advance the levator and shorten it and attach it to the tarsus. So, I have taken a partial thickness bite of the tarsus. Eversion of the tarsus is done to see that it is not full thickness so that you don't injure the cornea while the eyelid moves up and down. And then this suture, which is usually a non-absorbable monofilament polypropylene suture, is then tied on a temporary knot to see the elevation of the eyelid. Similar stitches are taken medially and laterally to adjust the contour. So the function of the central suture is to lift, and the function of the medial and the lateral suture is to adjust the contour of the eyelid. After this is done, you just evaluate the position with the help of the other eyelid and how you want it, and then the eyelid is closed. Some people also like to take a crease-forming suture, which passes from the levator muscle to the skin to give a good eyelid crease, but usually it is not found necessary. Even if you don't find, the levator finds a way to attach to the skin. Now, this is the closure, and this is how surgery ends. The recovery usually happens in 5 to 7 days, and stitches are removed. In a case of congenital ptosis, we use, in a very small child, we would use an absorbable suture so that we don't have the problem of removing the stitch. Now, second surgery, which we very commonly perform, is a frontalis sling surgery. Now, frontalis sling surgery, I'll be showing here, is basically a use of Ethibond. So in this child, you can see that what I'm marking is the lateral eyelid. So a lot of people would hitch the suture here. I prefer to hitch it in the lateral eyelid so that the chances of extrusion and granuloma formation and protrusion in the forehead region is less. So this is basically a tunneling technique. You make a single stab incision here, and then pass the stitch from the lateral to the eyelid, two eyelid marks, to the medial upper eyebrow, forehead, and then here. Local infiltration is done just to have adequate hemostasis. All the sites are infiltrated with local anesthesia, which also has a little bit of adrenaline. A single stab incision is done with the help of a 15 number BP handle and blade. And then you do a little bit of dissection so that you are beneath the subcutaneous plane. Now you can use 3-0 Ethibond suture, which is already attached on a long enough needle for the passes. eye guard is placed in position so that you don't damage the eyeball. The eyeball is pushed down by the assistant and then passages are made. Now it is important to just rub the periosteum here so that you take a bite of the orbital septum, evert the eyelid and see that you have not made a full thickness entry. And the passage of the suture is from the orbicularis septum, periosteum and the frontalis muscle. Again, you see that the exit is being done from the supra-brow incision medially. And then you see how the contour can be adjusted. Now, the final pass is through the frontalis muscle. And then this frontalis pass would then again be brought to the lateral eyebrow part. And then the suture is tight. Now, traction done in itself. Usually, you should leave the eye height at or 1 millimeter beneath the limbus. Because usually, we perform sling surgeries in cases of poor lateral function. So the eyelid drops by 1 or 2 millimeters postoperatively. These are just exteriorizing sutures so that granuloma formation is less. And then a frost suture is applied because the children are very small and you don't want to take them again and again to the OT in cases of exposure keratopathy. Third, the last video, which is a very short and quick video, is that of a Muller's muscle resection. You don't see this surgery very commonly. This is done in cases of very mild ptosis. Now, this is the same lady which I had shown in the case scenarios. In Muller's muscle resection, what you do is you evert the eyelid on a Demar's retractor. You mark the edge of the tarsus, the lower edge of the tarsus, and measure the amount of Muller's that you want to resect. In this case, I wanted to resect around 6 millimeters of Muller's because I wanted around 1.5 millimeters of correction. There are nomograms for this again. An assistant holds the conjunctiva at the marked part and then with the help of a Puttmann's clamp. Now, this is a specialized instrument that you require for this surgery. You clamp the Muller's muscle and the conjunctiva, whatever you had planned to resect. After this clamping is done, you check whether the clamp is only holding this part. And then in a very easy manner, you pass a 6-0 polypropylene suture in a serpentine fashion guided by these small holes on the clamp. So I'm passing the polypropylene suture back and forth. And this polypropylene suture is then exteriorized on the opposite side here and then run through again through the same markings to the opposite side and exteriorized here. Now the two exteriorizing sutures, one medially and one laterally, are tied so that there is a constriction around the clamp. In oculoplastic lingo, this surgery is also called as eyelid circumcision because it is very similar to circumcision surgery. And then you remove the amount of Muller's muscle that has been clamped and place a bandage contact lens because you don't want the cornea to be aberrated with the suture. So this surgery is very easy. Results are very quick and cosmetically appealing. You don't have to adjust the eyelid crease or bother about a scar or an incision on the skin or suture removal. So Muller's muscle resection is a surgery which is performed for cases of mild to moderate ptosis and not severe ptosis. Thank you. Is there any questions or madam, if you have any comments?
No. I think it was a very wonderful presentation and very enlightening. And Sumit, is there anything you would like to?
Hello. No, ma'am. That's covered everything very well. And this is what they commonly ask, like what are the materials that can be used instead of facial ATA, when the surgery can be done, and when how do you choose between the LPA surgery and the sling surgery. So I think those points have been clear to the students. And we will be also broadcasting this on the YouTube channel of BUA iTalks Plugged In. So those who want to revise or those who have missed the lecture, join late, can go through the video on the YouTube itself. So Adit, any closing remarks?
No, that means if anyone has any more doubts, you can always email or call me or message me and clear the doubts, which we could not clear here. I'm open. As it is in lockdown, we are not working full time, so we have a lot of time to answer doubts and help in whatever way possible.
Thank you, Adit, and thank you, ma'am, for your time and lecture. And we'll meet again after 2 days on Thursday for another lecture in the series. Ma'am, with your permission, can I end the meeting?
Yeah. Thank you, okay. Aditya. Thank you so much for the great coordination.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.